Hey guys, welcome back to What the Fat. Today I have someone on that I've been following for a very long time, someone who's really changing the paradigm. I think he broke through one of the plateaus that I think we had a big challenge of battling, like the fat controversy, right? Like back in the 50s, you had Ansel Keys who was like, hey, fat's bad and it's gonna kill you. And then all of a sudden, we're starting to see that kind of change in paradigm come around. But one of the other aspects that I think needs to get broken through even more so that he's really leading the charge on is this concept of like salt is gonna kill you and having too much of it is horrible for everyone. I think that's one of the biggest aspects. So today, I am extremely honored to have on Dr. James Dinicolantonio. Did I hit that right?
You got it right.
I got it. Yes. How's it going?
Good. How are you, Ryan?
Good, man. Good. Well, I appreciate everything you've done, but if people don't know about you, they've kind of been underneath a rock because your work's everywhere. I think the salt fix and then now Superfuel, which we'll talk about a little bit later on, but it's just two incredible resources and everything you put out. But can you tell everyone a little bit about your background? Like talk a little bit about like you coming up, like your schooling and what kind of really got you into this?
Yeah, so I graduated with my Doctor of Pharmacy in 2010 from the University of Buffalo. And then I became a cardiovascular research scientist at St. Luke's Mid-America Heart Institute. I've been doing that for about 5 or 6 years now. So basically, my job is literally to just mine the data and publish academic papers. That's like isn't that the coolest job ever?
Wow, that's amazing, yeah.
So basically, you know, I started out actually publishing about medications, being a pharmacist, right? And then when I started realizing that a lot of the medicines that were being prescribed actually didn't have a lot of evidence, I kind of got a little bit tired of publishing on medications and wanted to focus on something that could actually prevent the diseases that I was seeing in my own patients in the community. So I started focusing more on nutrition. And so I became an associate editor of BMJ Open Heart, which is a medical journal, and also I'm the associate editor of nutrition. So I review, you know, a lot of papers every year and you know, probably publish about 30 or 40 papers a year.
Amazing, man. And those are two, like, highly respected journals. Like, journals that, like, I love seeing publications in because they're so, like, it's such a good journal. So that's amazing to have you on top of that. And then to date, I think I read in the book, like, it's super impressive. To date, you've had over how many publications?
I think I'm at like a 235 around about.
That's like ridiculous. Like to kind of put that in perspective, like most people who are like PhDs or academics, they'd be happy with like 50, like 100. Like that's absolutely incredible. So one of the things I wanna go into a little bit is like your journey. You basically said, hey, I was tired of like watching some of these things, researching some of these pharmaceuticals that maybe weren't having an effect. Like a lot of the times you see in pharmaceutical research, one of the things I want to ask you, because a good friend of mine, Dr. David Diamond, talks a lot about this with like statins. How can you describe a little bit about like pharmaceutical research for people that have no idea, like there that these pharmaceutical research studies involve like thousands and thousands of patients and like the changes that you see, like what is it like? Like what is pharmaceutical research like and how has that kind of evolved?
Yeah, so I think to your point around statins, a lot of times what's used is the relative risk reduction. So for example, if a population in the control group that's not getting a statin has a 2% risk of having a cardiovascular event and a statin cuts it by 50%, that sounds like a lot, but that means their risk is only 1%. So you may have 98 people that are not having an event, so two people having an event, let's say instead of two people having a cardiovascular event in the control group, only one person has a cardiovascular event. So you do need to look at absolute risk versus relative risk, so that's important. Also, it's important to know who funded the study. A lot of the times, pharmaceutical research is funded by their own company, and if it isn't independently monitored, like normally it should be independently monitored by a research board, you know, that can call into question some of the results.
For sure, for sure. And, you know, I'm glad you brought up the whole relative risk thing because a lot of times people don't understand stats. Like still to this day, stats like are like crazy, but you just have to be very careful, right? And cautious. And I'm glad you're on more of like the preventative side of like, hey, how do we get to this before it actually happens now, versus like, hey, here's something that's happened, how do we now prescribe something that has a million side effects and then it's maybe beneficial for like 2% of people? It's like, so I think that's amazing. One of the things that is just a game changer, it's something that I've read and I kind of have it on my bookshelf as like an absolute staple, and I recommend it to everyone. It's really how I learned and discovered about you, because every conference I would go to, everyone would be like, well, what about salt? Like, what about salt intake? And I'm like, no, like, especially on a ketogenic diet, like, you're salting everything. Like, I have like 5 to 6 grams of salt, sodium a day, and like, I'm putting it on everything. And they're like, you're going to be hypertensive. Like, your blood pressure is going to go through the roof. And every single time I'm like, you have to read this book. Like, and I'm like shelling out the salt fix. And I'm like, dang, this is such a good resource. So can you just talk a little bit about what got you interested in like the salt fix, and like what inspired that book to be created?
I think like inherently, I always knew the benefits of salt being a wrestler and a cross country runner in high school. Like, any athlete kind of inherently knows salt is pretty important to help their exercise routine. Right. But I didn't like really look into the research until when I was practicing as a community pharmacist. I kept having patients coming up to me and were saying, you know, Dr. D, basically my doctor threw me on a blood pressure medicine because my blood pressure was high, and they're also telling me to cut my salt intake. I mean, literally the first thing doctors will tell you if they find a slightly elevated blood pressure is to cut your salt intake, as if it's like some white poison and not some essential mineral, which is kind of crazy when you really think about it. But as I started pushing back my patients, and they were going to their doctors and saying, well, you know, my pharmacist was saying that maybe I am low on salt, like the dizziness that I'm having on this low salt diet, I can't exercise as well. Everything was improved as soon as they upped their salt intake. So from that perspective, and I saw such a quick change in my own patient's health, I wanted to start actually researching the data. And if you actually look, there's not a single study that proves lowering salt intake is going to prolong your life or reduce cardiovascular events. In fact, most of the studies actually show the exact opposite.
Mind blowing. So think about like, where did this entire low salt, like, we know we kind of talk a lot about Ansel Keys in the keto world of like this whole conundrum of where it all started. Where did this whole concept of like, hey, if you want to reduce your blood pressure, you need to lower salt, where did that even stem from?
Yeah, so like, honestly, the story where we demonize salt is very similar to the story of how we demonized animal fat. And basically, you had someone was named Lewis Dahl. He was basically the Ansel Keys for salt. He did the exact same thing. He literally looked at about 6 populations, drew this basically line, this straight line saying, okay, with these 6 countries, the more salt they eat, the higher the risk of hypertension. And that came out, that was published in like the 1960s. And he also genetically modified rats to be salt sensitive and was extrapolating that data to human babies. So basically it was like animal data that he genetically created animals salt sensitive. Because I actually show in the salt fix that a normal rat, it takes like the equivalent of 100 grams of salt to induce hypertension. So even in, you know, normal rats, you can't do it. But even in salt-sensitive rats, you need about 20 grams of salt in order to increase blood pressure. That's so crazy. I mean, the evidence was pretty scarce to begin with. And then, I mean, Inner Salt came out in 1988, so like 30 years after Lewis Dahl published his 6 countries, quote-unquote, study. And when you actually combined 48 countries, blood pressure actually went down slightly as salt intake increased. So when you actually look at more data, it's very similar to fat, right? Like 5 years after Ansel Keys published, it was called the 6-country study. This was right before the 7-country study. They plotted all the 22 countries and it showed no like link with animal fat. So it's just like bad data drove all of these misconceptions with salt.
That's crazy. And it's scary to watch people like that, like coming out with around the fat and now coming around with the salt, caused so many changes to happen in health, and like we're still facing it today, right? And that's the scary part, is like it wasn't really like this huge experiment that was really well controlled. A lot of it's correlational data, and it's like, yep, we're really like, we're going to the doctor still to this day. And I have so many friends, I have family members, like my father went to the doctor and his blood pressure was like slightly high. The first thing, he's like, you got to cut the salt. So my dad was like super worried about, and I was like, what? I'm like, no, like, I was like, let's focus on cutting the French fries, not the sauce. I was like, that's a different story. But I'm like,
No,
dang,
absolutely.
dang. So I want to ask, because I know a lot of people are going to be like, well, what about people who are maybe pre-hypertensive or hypertensive? You're saying there's no data really at this point showing, hey, salt alone, just cutting salt alone, having no, not even talking about nutrition, cutting salt really doesn't have an effective change in their blood pressure. Is that right?
Yeah. So basically, so if we're focusing on people with pre-hypertension, only about 30% of those people actually will get a significant rise in blood pressure. And when I say a significant rise, I'm honestly only talking about 5 or 10%. They're probably going to have the same reduction in heart rate when they up their salt intake. So who's to say they're at higher risk when you actually combine both heart rate and blood pressure, which is what determines the stress on the arteries and your heart. So hyper-focusing on blood pressure, yeah, maybe 30% of that population may seem at risk, but then when you start bringing in the other surrogate markers that are worsened on a low salt diet, including inducing insulin resistance, including elevations in all the stress hormones, like adrenaline, noradrenaline, and all the artery stiffening hormones like aldosterone, renin, angiotensin II, which are all increased by about 3 to 4 fold when you cut your salt intake, mind you. These are hormones we block with medicines to reduce cardiovascular events, by the way. Or people could just eat a normal salt diet, you know, pick your poison, so to speak. But yeah, so even in those people, there's not a single study to show that in prehypertensives or hypertensives, cutting their salt intake is going to prolong their life or reduce cardiovascular events. Not a single study. And even in hypertensives, only about 1 out of 2 people will actually have a significant increase in blood pressure when they increase their salt intake. And really, it's all about like root cause. Like, why are you having an elevation in your blood pressure when you up your salt intake? That should not happen because your blood is super salty. Like, your blood contains 3,200 milligrams of sodium per liter. Your own blood isn't trying to kill you. You know what I mean? So if you're consuming a teaspoon of salt, which is only 2,300 milligrams of sodium, so that's like not even a lot when you look at how salty your own blood is. Why would that cause an increase in blood pressure? And really, in the book, I outline some of the most common reasons why, but the three main causes: insulin resistance, high aldosterone levels, or high cortisol levels. You fix those three, and you're probably going to eliminate at least 50% of the people who are quote unquote salt sensitive.
Wow, that's crazy. So you do see, basically, you do see people that maybe are more salt sensitive than people who aren't, but those three keys are really what you say are gonna address most of the root cause of what's causing that salt sensitivity, so to speak.
Yeah, so most people are not salt sensitive, but in hypertensives, yep, 1 out of 2 are salt sensitive. And probably half of those people, if you got at the root cause, you would completely eliminate their salt sensitivity.
That's amazing. I wish that, like, I'm glad you're getting this information out because it's such a prevalent problem. I think so many people are dealing with that. Now, one of
Yep.
the things I want to ask personally, is not myself, but just family members or friends, that are like heavy drinkers or people who are on, like, I know you talked in the book about like antidepressants and you talked about like a case study with antidepressants. These people, I'm interested in like people, these are heavy drinkers, and because they're going to the bathroom a lot, right? When you drink, you're excreting out a lot more fluids. Do you see in people who have, say, like alcoholism, is their salt like really low? And do you think that that's kind of contributing to some of the problems that they're facing?
Yeah, I think certain people, I would honestly more focus on people that drink coffee because coffee or caffeine is a tremendous waster of salt. And when I actually started looking at the studies, I was like, why didn't I realize that? Like, I know it's a diuretic, but it's actually a really, really big depleter of salt. So like, I noticed you kind of drinking something out of your mug there. Could be caffeinated. I just finished like 4 cups of coffee this morning. But, you know, we're all like these Java junkies now, and we're slowly being depleted of salt and not even realizing it. Alcohol, not so much. It's a little bit of a diuretic, but you pee more free water out when you drink alcohol. Coffee, caffeine is more of a salt waster. And the thing is your kidneys never adapt to that. You continually, like anyone who drinks coffee that knows they're running to the bathroom, after 3 weeks, your kidneys don't adapt to it. You keep running to the bathroom. So, it's not something that your kidneys will shut down after just a few weeks of drinking coffee. This is a chronic problem. And to just give you a perspective of how much salt you lose drinking coffee, 4 cups of coffee on average will cause you to lose 1/2 teaspoon of salt. And yet the American Heart Association tells you to eat less than that every single day, which is kind of crazy.
That's crazy. And I bet you for some people, they're like some people are like, I wish I only drank 4 cups of coffee. Like I know people that are like 6, 7, 8 cups a day. That
for sure.
is insane. And then those people, like, they're definitely not replenishing that. So like those are the people that if you're having any type of coffee or caffeine, you need to be extra worried about like taking in more salt. Wow.
Exactly.
That's insane. One of the things that you talked about in the book, that, and you went through a lot of different things about some of the dangers of having a low sodium intake. Can you touch on some of those of like, what are some of the challenges or complications that you see people face when they aren't, like they are drinking a ton of caffeine or coffee, or they aren't supplementing or being conscientious of how much sodium they're taking in? What are some of the downsides to being a very low sodium or low salt intake user?
Yeah. So like the main benefit of salt is that it gives you a blood pressure. I mean, I know people like are scared of blood pressure, but if you didn't have blood pressure, we'd all be dead. So it actually is one of your best boosters of plasma volume and blood circulation. So the first thing that I see people suffering from is dizziness, orthostatic hypotension. So when they go from a seated to a standing position, they feel faint and their exercise tolerance is horrible. So if exercise is the best thing we can do for our health or one of the best things, cutting salt makes no sense. And the studies actually show dosing yourself with salt prior to exercise allows you to exercise 21 minutes longer in the heat, and also reduces core body temperature by a full degree Fahrenheit. So you are much less at risk of, let's say, like heat stroke, because it literally your blood circulation is so much better when you up your salt intake. That fluid circulation actually cools the body off quicker. And it was interesting. I used to think that the more salt you consumed, you actually will sweat more. But because the extra salt cools you off, you actually, the studies show you sweat less when you eat more salt because you're cooler. So your body doesn't need to produce as much sweat to cool you off, which I thought was pretty cool when I actually started reading the literature on how effective salt is. Way better than anything I've ever seen. Any supplement for improving your exercise capacity is dosing yourself with salt before exercise. So exercise intolerance is definitely one of the top things I will see when people cut their salt intake.
Interesting. That's fascinating. And anytime someone's asked me about this, I say, if you go back to like the original Gatorade formula, not what's available out on the market now, but like, I think in some aspects, not with like how much sugar they have in it, but like in some aspects, they were kind of ahead of their time of like, hey, we have all these athletes, like we need to have some type of electrolytes to like replenish it. And I think like the original one was ridiculously salty. And then like to mainstream it, they had to like cut some of that back. And now it's just like, oh, it's just, it's obviously a huge brand. But that's super interesting to think about. Like people that were ultimately ahead of their time. I think you've been one of those people that are ahead of like the curve of like really trying to instigate this change. How do you see, like right now, one of the big things in the keto community, which we'll talk about in a little bit, how do you see like exogenous ketones that are out in the market now? A lot of them are bound to mineral salts. Is there a difference in the type of sodium or the type of salt that's being utilized that will have an impact? And like, can these exogenous ketones, can some of the benefits that's being conferred from them be the result of like people are now taking in an extra 1 to 2 grams of sodium per day, whereas they weren't before?
Yeah, I definitely think that if people are limiting their salt intake and they're getting more salt through exogenous ketones, I think that's probably a good amount of where the benefit is actually coming from. Because I think there are some studies, like I think the jury's still out on exogenous ketones, right? Like if you take them, it may reduce your own fat burning and your own ketone production. So, you know, I think the jury's still out with regards to benefits of exogenous ketones. I'm not saying they're bad. I'm not saying they're good. I'm a scientific guy, so I just need more data, really, what it comes down to. But I think that absolutely, if people are limiting their salt intake and they're getting more salt from exogenous ketones, that could be a benefit. And I do think there are, I'm not an advocate of table salt, basically because it's stripped of all its minerals and it's highly processed and it's bleached white. There's a bunch of like, you know, issues with table salt. But I do like certain high mineral salts. My favorite is Redmond real salt because it's basically an underground ancient type of salt. So the sea salts that you get from, let's say, an ocean are contaminated with microplastics and nanoplastics. So if you get an ancient underground source salt, you're not going to have that issue, but it also has good amounts of iodine. And we actually lose a tremendous amount of iodine through exercise. Like when I was researching, I thought, geez, I think you only lose salt when you sweat. Not the case. You lose potentially like 50 to 100 micrograms of iodine per hour of exercise. You're supposed to consume 150 micrograms of iodine per day. So literally 1 to 2 hours of exercise can completely deplete the recommended dietary intake of iodine. So you want a good salt that brings iodine with it.
That's a really good recommendation. I love that one as well. I use it all the time, like just crack it over everything that I eat. So there's, and I'm not as familiar with all the different types of salt, but like there's table salt. And then like you have like the Redmond's real salt, which it would be on like the best version of the end of the spectrum. Where would like a traditional like sea salt that you find at like the store, what would that, where would that fall into play?
Yeah, I think it kind of falls like in the middle, because like, you know, this actually, a lot of people think sea salt has iodine in it, and actually almost all sea salts have virtually no iodine. Wow. So it's just a little bit less of a processed salt compared to table salt. But again, you, at least table salt, actually most table salts are coming from under the ground, whereas sea salts are actually coming from a highly polluted ocean. So I don't know actually how I would honestly rank it. It's kind of tough, but it's nowhere near the super good end of the spectrum, so to speak.
Right, right. Probably better than table salt, but probably not as good as like a Redmond's real salt with iodine.
Exactly.
Interesting. Now, one of the questions that I know is going to get brought up all the time is when you increase sodium intake, when you're having more and more and more, should you pair that with potassium? And if so, supplement, food form, what do you typically recommend or suggest?
Yeah, I'm really glad you mentioned that because a lot of people can maybe take this message and be like, I'm going to dump salt on everything and still eat a really bad diet.
Right.
And it's like, no, you shouldn't do that. I use salt for not only my own diet, but getting my kids to eat healthier, high potassium, high magnesium foods that tend to be really bitter that I hate spinach. Without salt or like a salty brine, I will not eat spinach. And it's like, spinach is one of the like healthiest foods you can eat. Right. High in magnesium, high in potassium, high in betaine. Can't get that, those good healthy minerals without salt. So use it as a tool to eat healthy and exercise better. And those are the two key messages I really want people to get, that don't just eat salt to eat bad food, use it to eat healthier food.
I love that. I love that message. And is there a type of, like, I know avocados, I'm a huge fan of avocados. I eat them all the time. Yeah. Is like, they're really rich in potassium. But like when it comes to supplemental form, is there a certain type of potassium that you think pairs well with people who are increasing salt intake?
That's a good question. So I like to get my potassium through diet, like through foods. Mm-hmm. So cooked and cooled potatoes, cooked and cooled beans. So this is lowering this, basically the starch or glucose and upping the fiber. So I know a lot of people in the keto world might freak out when I say I eat cooked and cooled potatoes, but they're actually a lot lower. When I actually undercook the potatoes too. So it's not like this super mushy potato that I'm eating. It's like a giant fiber bomb.
Yeah.
But basically, that's a good way to get potassium. But I drink Gerald Steiner water because it's high in bicarbonate, which basically promotes more of a base in your body. And salt actually is acidic. So if you're not consuming either some type of bicarbonate through fruits, vegetables, or like a Gerald Steiner water, you may potentially have some issues. Now, jury's still out. A lot of people get a little freaked out about the alkaline diet, thinking there's no evidence to it. But there are studies showing that if you give potassium bicarbonate or up people's fruit or vegetable intake, particularly if they have kidney issues and can't excrete the acid, there is an increase in net acid load. So it is important that if you're upping salt intake, you do match it with some type of substance that forms bicarbonate in the body.
Great recommendation. Now, one of the things I want to wrap this segment up with is Your recommendations for salt intake. So someone who's listening to this and they're like, you know what? I want to take Dr. James's message. I want to go forward. Like, I really, like, everyone's now hung up on like the new year, new me sort of thing. We're going into that time where people are starting to make changes. Like, if someone really wants to institute this and you're going to say, hey, beyond just the diet, right? You need to focus on like getting exercise. We'll talk a little bit later about keto or even lower carbohydrate intake. But with sodium recommendation or like salt recommendations, what do you recommend to like your average person of like, hey, make sure you're doing this?
Yeah, I honestly, I'm not smarter than your own body. So anyone that tells you to like not listen to your own salt cravings is insane. So just to give you like an example, there was a paper published in JAMA where this toddler was constantly consuming salt. And because salt was demonized, they hospitalized this kid, strapped the kid down to a hospital bed. And he actually had basically a salt wasting kidney disease, and they ended up killing him. So his own body was telling him to eat loads and loads of salt. So if you're that person that constantly salts their food, there is a reason why your body is telling you to do that. Just like if you're someone who's drinking a ton of water, there's a reason why your body's telling you you're thirsty. So if you go against your own salt cravings, I think that's stupid. And that's probably the best meter that anyone can kind of take in regards to how much salt they should be consuming per day.
I love that. I love that. So great recommendation. I feel the exact same way. Listen to your body. The more you can get in tune with it, the better off you're going to be. So I think there's a lot of gems that people can take away in regards to salt, even with or without a ketogenic diet, but just so many gems. I want to switch gears a little bit and go into talking about your lifestyle. You brought up something that I think is going to be very interesting, and it's kind of going to kind of blow some people's minds of like, wait a minute, what's this cooked and cool thing? But can we just talk a little bit about like a day in your life? Like what does a typical eating day look like for you?
So yeah, I'm not your typical quote unquote person that follows the typical ketogenic diet. So I think there are good ways to do keto, right? Like eating whole foods, wild salmon, you know, plant foods. And then there's a bad way to do keto, just loads of butter and bacon and processed bacon, right? So like on the spectrum, I try to be on the super fuel side of the spectrum, so to quote unquote, that fats do, there's different fats that have different kind of metabolic effects on your body. So my typical diet, I probably skip breakfast 3 or 4 days a week. Mm-hmm. So that's my quote unquote intermittent fast. Usually those are days where I didn't work out the previous day. So my body's not craving the extra protein. And then 3 or 4 days of the week, I will start breakfast with basically 2 pastured eggs, and I'll eat 1 slice of Ezekiel bread. Don't freak out when I say the word bread. Ezekiel bread is a sprouted grain. It's organic. And it has very low net carb. It's like, honestly, 1 slice is maybe like 10 net carbs, 3 grams of fiber. The reason why I do that is because animal fats are great and super healthy, but we have to kind of look at our environmental pollutants. So persistent organic pollutants, they persist in our store in animal fat. The only natural way to bind those organic pollutants is plant fiber. So I will consume a little bit, not a lot, of some type of plant fiber to bind those persistent organic pollutants that do accumulate in animal fat. Again, I love animal fat. I think animal fat is great for cooking, super stable, provides a ton of vitamins, but I try to integrate both plant foods and animal foods to enhance the ketogenic diet. I don't think there's one way to do it. So that's breakfast. May or may not eat breakfast. Lunch will be normally chicken and pork. Doesn't have to be grass-fed. Preferably grass-fed would be great, but I know a lot of people can't afford that. Then I will consume some beans for the potassium, for the bicarbonate, for some of the polyphenols in black beans. Won't consume a ton of them, but I will eat some. I may even consume a little brown rice if I'm going to work out that day. So I do a little bit more carbs when I work out. That's more of my cyclical ketogenic diet. Integrate things like tomatoes, and then for dinner, probably pork chops, spinach, and a salty brine for the spinach so I can actually eat it. That's honestly my typical day.
That's awesome, man. Now, on days that you do intermittent fasting, does your salt intake change? Like, do you incorporate in more or less salt when you're fasting versus if you're not fasting?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, it honestly, my salt intake is determined by my coffee intake, which is pretty much depending on like how much I'm writing that day. I'm gonna need to be fueled by a lot of coffee. So, I will up my salt intake on days that I'm writing, drinking coffee, or exercising. And I kind of talk about certain ways of how I integrate salt prior to exercise, which we can talk about if you want. But yeah, what's really crazy about fasting is that your body actually is unable to shut off salt loss when you fast. And that's kind of crazy because you would think that the body could completely shut off salt loss, but it can't. So when you fast, just like when you go on a ketogenic diet, you actually do need salt. And basically, how much the kidneys excrete salt is determined by insulin levels. So because you're fasting and insulin is so low, either on a ketogenic diet or fasting, your kidneys will spill salt. So you definitely need to match on that loss.
Definitely, definitely. I talk about that all the time. It's one of the main things that I think 90% of people who start like even a ketogenic diet in general, they're like, "Hey, I feel like crap and the keto flu," and they get like this concept. I'm like, "Cool, just bump up your sodium and match it with potassium." Like that solves like 90% of their complications because they don't realize that they're excreting out so much more because insulin's now low. So, huge, huge point. You talked a little bit about incorporating in like your protocol around salt before workouts. What is that? What is that like?
Yeah, so the worst thing you can do is dump salt in water because it's gonna taste like you're drinking sweat. Like that's the worst thing you can do. So the best way to integrate salt is what I do is I take about a teaspoon of Redmond real salt if I'm gonna be working out in the heat. If I'm not working out and it's under 80 degrees Fahrenheit, I'm only doing a half a teaspoon. So that's kind of an important point. Your salt intake should be determined by how much you're gonna sweat and how hot it is, and actually how intense your workout's going to be too. But basically anywhere from a half a teaspoon to a full teaspoon of Redmond real salt. I will coat the salt with just enough lemon juice to coat it, and then I will just basically pour about 1 ounce of water. Take it like a shot, so it goes down really good, like a lemon shot. And then I will consume about 20 ounces of fluid over the course of 30 minutes. That's going to boost your plasma volume by about 10%, which when you exercise, a lot of the fluid is shunted towards your activated muscles, and so your plasma volume goes down by about 10%. So you're going to boost your plasma volume to match the loss that happens when your muscles are basically taking up that extra fluid.
Great point. And I just saw a paper, I'm sure you saw it, it was published maybe less than a month or 2 months ago, that was talking about like people that were super concerned about, hey, hypertension, I'm eating too much salt. It's like, cool, we'll just drink more water. And they kind of looked at like that balance between the two of like people, yeah, if you're gonna pound salt and you're super dehydrated, that might be a complication versus like if you're actually well hydrated and having salt. So that's another question I want to talk to you about. Like, do you see people all the time, and this is why you encourage it, obviously, but do you see people who encourage them to drink water, but people who are dehydrated and they're consuming more and more salt, like, do you see that as being any type of issue if they're like really dehydrated and say they're not drinking water for some weird reason? Would that be an issue?
100%. So absolutely, one of the benefits of eating more salt is it automatically causes you to drink more water. And so a lot of people are super scared of salt because they think it's going to cause kidney stones. And the actual studies show the exact opposite, that your water intake goes up, you dilute the urine, and there's less risk of actually stones forming because your urine's more diluted. So actually salt is a potential antidote to people who are having kidney stones, which is cool because again, ups the water intake, reduces dehydration. It was interesting. There was an animal study that recently came out showing that bacon actually reduced colon cancer. And the part of the reason why is because bacon was so salty, it was causing the mice to drink more water and diluting the concentrations of the toxins in their fecal matter. So salt is
Interesting.
literally potentially a way to reduce, potentially carcinogenesis by improving your hydration status, peeing out and excreting through the feces more of the toxins that you get in the environment.
So interesting. That's great. Like, I feel like I need to like go throw some salt in this right now. That's awesome. Now, is there like an upper limit? Like, if someone's just like crazy, because most people in the key, like people that have like, hey, I'm going low carb or I'm going keto, and they kind of have it. They might have been doing it for like a month or 2 months. By that time, you figured out like, hey, I need to have more salt. But is there a level where it's like, hey, if I'm having 15 or 20 grams, like, and even if I am working out, would that ever be sort of an issue?
Yeah, I think people should absolutely, if they're going to increase their salt intake, monitor their blood pressure to see if they're salt sensitive, because then you can get at the root cause, like maybe you're consuming too much sugar or refined carbs or not enough potassium, and that's why your blood pressure is skyrocketing, or you're retaining water when you're consuming more salt. Water retention and swelling and edema in the feet when you eat salt should not happen. That is literally indicating that there is a true underlying issue. So yeah, I do think it's good for people to test, but in regards to an upper limit for like people like you and me who aren't salt sensitive, I mean, I have battled with Loren Cordain about like salt intake during evolutionary times. Like, so I'm like, dude, we could have literally followed animals to a salt lick. We literally ate salt like the blood. We would consume the whole animal. Like, he's like, no, we never got salt. I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, let me go through every single thing that we could have gotten salt from and show you why you're wrong. And he was like showing me spreadsheets of like only like muscle meat on land. And I'm like, well, we would eat more than just the muscle meat on land. We could just walk to a salt lick or like drink brackish water if we wanted to. We weren't stupid. But if you look at the last 10,000 years, we've been consuming anywhere from 2 to 10 times more salt because we packaged everything. We didn't have refrigerators. We used salt as our preservative. So Romans consumed 25 grams of salt per day. And even looking at today's populations, Japan, South Korea, France, they all eat some of the highest, saltiest diets, and they live the longest, and they have the lowest risk of heart disease.
Fascinating. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the interplay between like sugar and sodium, right? Because you talk a little bit about that. What kind of relationship do you see there? Where like people, maybe is it like, hey, if I eat more sodium, I'm less inclined to crave some of these sugary foods. What are you seeing of that relationship?
Yeah, there's a huge like relationship between insulin levels and sugar and salt. So low salt is literally just as bad on insulin resistance as high sugar. So people need to let that sink in for a second. If you aren't getting enough salt, it literally can cause you to become insulin resistant the same degree as eating a high amount of sugar. If you look at any oral glucose tolerance test study on a low salt diet, it increases the AUC of glucose, let's say on a 75 gram load, by about 40 to 60%. So the same as you would see with a high sugar diet. So salt is very important to maintaining insulin sensitivity. And then there's a relationship in the brain between sugar and salt. So you have taste receptors for both sugar and salt. When you're not getting enough salt, your brain becomes hyperactivated. So the reward system in your brain is super activated when you're not getting enough salt. That tells you to go and seek out more salt. That is our salt thermostat that prevents us and as well as animals from dying of salt deficiency. The problem with low salt diets, now that your reward center is super activated in the brain, is things like sugar and drugs of abuse can hijack that elevated hyper reward in the brain. And literally, animal studies show that if you induce salt deficiency in an animal, they are more they get a much higher reward from substances like Adderall, cocaine, and sugar. So literally, salt can help treat sugar craving, but potentially even drug addiction.
Wow, that's powerful, man. That's extremely powerful. Can you talk a little bit about the mechanism? Because that kind of just like blew my mind of like low salt intake and insulin resistance. Why would someone who has such a really low salt intake have that degree of insulin resistance?
Yeah, so insulin resistance, how that happens, one of the mechanisms is through the kidneys. The way the kidneys want to retain salt on a low salt diet is by upping the insulin levels so they can maintain your salt status. So the body simply becomes insulin resistant to allow the kidneys to retain more salt. But there's also an increase in blood flow to the liver when you up your salt intake, and the liver is what breaks down insulin. So if there's a reduction in blood flow to the liver as well as the muscle when you lower your salt intake, your muscle isn't the reduction in the blood flow is reducing the uptake also of glucose to your muscle. And so glute transporters are downregulated with low salt diets as well. So you can't, your muscles can't soak up glucose as well when you're on a low salt diet too.
I agree. I think a lot of times blood flow gets often overlooked. It's one of the reasons why I think it's one of the contributing factors, not the main one, but like with people who are aging, they have decreased blood flow and you're starting to see more and more insulin resistance. And it's like, well, if you can improve the blood flow, maybe there's a possibility that you start helping some of that insulin resistance. And that could be done by bumping up some of the salt intake. Really, really cool. Now, I want to dive more into this fat concept. So you're a cardiovascular research scientist. You've been studying this for a very, very long time. You're kind of going, literally, you go against the grain, like literally, in a sense that a lot of times, there was like, I think I did a video on it not too long ago, but put vegan aside, he was a guy that was like, he was a cardiologist, and he's like, a ketogenic diet's the worst thing you could ever do for heart health. So like, what made you kind of make that switch and say, you know what, maybe you're a data guy, let me look into this a little bit more. Even though I'm so focused on the heart, fat really isn't the culprit that's causing a lot of these heart issues by itself. What kind of triggered that, and what did you see?
Yeah, so I think in regards to, like, let's talk about, like, why I was researching super fuel and you know, why keto sometimes gets a bad rap is because a lot of people have a misconception of what a ketogenic diet should be. And that was the reason why I wrote Superfuel, is to actually say, no, there's a very good way to do a keto diet. And, you know, because in the beginning, several years ago, too, I thought fat was fat. There's no difference. But there is a tremendous difference in regard to, let's say, take, for example, omega-3s from wild salmon versus, let's say, long-chain saturated fats from heavy cream. Okay? So literally your own fat burning machine is upregulated when you consume more long chain omega-3s. So you can burn fat better. You're just a better fat burning machine when you up your omega-3 intake. So, you know, the ketogenic diets that aren't using or integrating more wild salmon, sushi, sashimi, things like that, yeah, maybe they don't burn fat as well because they're literally not activating their beta oxidation in the liver because they're not consuming enough long chain omega-3s. Whereas saturated fats, particularly from heavy cream or butter, not to say that butter and cream are bad, I love them. You do need to limit the quantity though, because they are more stored for fat and less liberated for energy. Take for example, medium chain triglycerides, they go right to the liver. They are more produced for ketone bodies. You're feeling that energy too, which causes you to potentially work out more, which is kind of crazy to think that the fats that you eat from the difference in liberation and energy can actually control if you have the energy to go and work out, or if you're storing fat, not feeling that energy released from the fat and sitting on the couch. Kind of crazy to think
about. Yeah, that's a great point. Absolutely great point. And I'm super excited to dive more into Superfuel. But one of the last questions I want to ask you here, and it's a question I get asked all the time, and I'm sure you've gotten asked about it all the time, and I think I have an idea of what your answer is going to be. But right now in the keto world, I'm glad to talk about a little bit about this well-formulated approach. I think a well-formulated ketogenic diet is very different from what some people just say, hey, this is a ketogenic diet. But right now in the keto world, there's this big craze surrounding carnivore, where people are just strictly eating meat and doing stuff like that. What are some of your thoughts? And you touched on it a little bit earlier, but like, what are some of your thoughts about like people that strictly eat just meat and things like butter?
Yeah. So I started off pro meat. I wanted meat to be this superfood. Who wouldn't? It tastes phenomenal. Okay. I am a science guy though. I cannot follow trends. I have to follow the science. Meat is super nutritious. Don't get me wrong. I eat meat, but I do things to protect and prevent the harms that come with meat. So one of the differences that people need to understand is that your supermarket meat is hung for 2 weeks, okay? And when I looked at the post-mortem changes that happen when blood flow stops to meet, it liberates free iron ions. And it sucks because I didn't want to see the study, but what ends up happening is when meat is hung for 2 weeks, you have a giant release of these free iron ions that oxidizes the proteins, the fats, the phospholipids. That's before you cook the hell out of the meat and oxidize it further. So there's things, strategies you can do to prevent those free iron ions from being absorbed. And the Maasai did it. They drank milk. So calcium can bind those free iron ions in meat. So that's just one strategy. The problem also with carnivore is, again, we live in an environmentally polluted world. So persistent organic pollutants concentrate in animal fat. And if you're a carnivore and you're not consuming animal fat with some plant fiber to bind those organic pollutants, you are doing yourself a disservice. I would love it if we could apply 2.6 million years ago the healthy foods that didn't contain environmental pollutants and animal fat, but we live now in the 21st century. And so we need to actually adapt our diet a little bit to optimize a quote-unquote carnivore diet. The other thing is I've researched minerals and vitamins for a decade. So I know that the vitamin C enzymes don't saturate until you eat 120 milligrams of vitamin C, and your tissues do not saturate until you consume 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C per day. And the problem with carnivore is when you cook the meat, you decrease the vitamin C, almost all of it. And so while your vitamin C requirements may not be as much on a carnivore diet, it's the proof is on the carnivore group and the people promoting it to say that the 5 milligrams or so of vitamin C that you're getting is an optimal amount when you can't even saturate the enzymes until you're getting at least 120 milligrams of vitamin C.
Wow, some really great points there. And I think I 100% agree. I talk about it. I say, hey, if someone's utilizing that approach as like a tool to like, or like an elimination phase to really figure out what foods are triggering them. But most people do exactly what you just said. And it's even worse of just saying, hey, I'm just going to buy the Walmart brand of meat and like eat that all the time. It's like, no, I'm going to go to Wendy's and McDonald's, just remove the bread. And like, I'm carnivore AF. And I'm like, oh gosh, we need a real, like, if you're going to take the approach of like trying to find the high quality meat, but then also eating like organs and some of those aspects of like really eating liver and animal heart, like that's a whole nother spectrum versus like, hey, I'm just going to go to Wendy's and have a Baconator without the bun sort of thing.
Exactly. No, that honestly, that is, I'm so glad you're on board too with my thoughts on it, because you're right. There's a bad way to do keto and a good way to do keto. And same with carnivore. You can do carnivore a lot better than a lot of people are doing. Like you said, just going to Wendy's drive-thru and eating 10 Wendy's patties and being like you said, I'm carnivore. I'm not eating the bun. It's right. Crazy.
Right. It's very different. So I'm super excited. I'm happy that we're kind of on the same page on that. And I think a lot of people are going to get a good chunk of information about you and your, what kind of like your approach is, and then hopefully they can institute it themselves. Lastly, I want to jump into super fuel. So I have it here with me. I have so many freaking notes in this thing. So we talked a little bit earlier about Salt Fix. I got all these notes in it, and now super fuel that you did with actually Dr. Mercola, another, like, he's just like a godfather in the space. Can you talk a little bit about like, first off, what inspired you guys to like come together and write this book?
I mean, really, the inspiration, again, was I wanted to provide a tool for people to do keto right in a well-formulated keto. So the words being thrown around a lot, a well-formulated keto, but I don't think a lot of people really know what that means. And I wanted to put out a easy, readable book that could give everyone the steps to do a well-formulated ketogenic diet. And it's honestly as simple as that.
I love it. I love it. So one of the first things that I noticed about Superfuel when I first started reading it is you really get deep into like different types of fats. And I think that's very important. You're saying, listen, all fats aren't the same. Can you, just for people that are listening, can you just quickly break down like the difference between unsaturated fat versus saturated fat versus what you have an entire chapter on, like trans fats?
Yeah. So basically, saturated fat, the carbon chains are completely saturated with hydrogen atoms. There are no double bonds. an unsaturated fat has either one double bond, so that would be a monounsaturated fat like oleic acid found in olive oil, or a polyunsaturated fat as you would find in plants or fish, things like that. And those have multiple double bonds. A trans fat is when you basically take a polyunsaturated fat and you sort of, if it's a partially hydrogenated fat, you basically add heat, add a catalyst, and induce and kind of artificially try to saturate it. And basically, that is what a trans fat is, basically a damaged polyunsaturated fat.
So with your, I know you talk a little bit about some of these recommendations. In regards to each one of those, saturated fat, unsaturated fat, and trans fats, which ones, like if people are going out and they're looking on like, hey, I'm looking at, I'm trying to figure out which one I should consume. Do you have like a ratio of like, hey, don't touch this one, maybe 50-50 or 70-30 on like saturated, unsaturated? What are your thoughts on like how much people should consume of each?
Yeah, I try to focus on foods and not fats per se. So I do think that, so for example, I will look at just the difference between butter, let's say, and olive oil. If basically, I mean, butter is great. If you get pastured butter, gives you the vitamin K2, which is basically helps prevent arterial calcification. There are advantages to consuming some pastured butter. But if you look at the thermic effect, which is the amount of energy your body uses just to metabolize a fat, it is twice as high with oleic acid or olive oil versus long chain saturated fats, meaning you burn twice the amount of calories simply metabolizing olive oil versus butter. So I do think that you do want to minimize foods that are high in long chain saturated fats. Consume some because they have benefits, but don't overdo it. And those foods would be heavy cream, cheese, and butter. I mean, they have benefits, but don't overdo it. Partly not just because thermic effect, but the beta oxidation rate of monounsaturated fats is higher than long chain saturated fats, meaning again, you're going to burn that fat better, whereas long chain saturated fats are going to be more stored. So that those are some of my reasons why I try to limit foods very high or a high intake of foods that are high in long chain saturated fats.
I 100% agree. Now, thinking about, this is just a personal question I have. What are your thoughts on different types of medium chain triglycerides? Because a lot of times this gets brought up all the time in the keto world is like, hey, people talk about C8, but then there's coconut oil, which has C12. Like, do you discuss that at all? Like, what are your kind of thoughts on the differences between the different MCT? Technically, you can classify C12 as an MCT or is it not an MCT? Like, what are your thoughts on the difference between those?
Yeah, I do think that the lauric acid, which is C12 in coconut oil, does get stored a little bit more as fat than, let's say, a C8 or a C10, which is what you typically find in an MCT oil. Some MCT oils claim that they're the best, that they're just C8, sort of the shorter the chain, the less it's going to be stored as fat. I think some quote-unquote medium chain triglyceride oils are even trying to use just butyric acid, which is even a shorter chain fat, to try to say this is the super MCT quote-unquote oil. But I don't get too caught up with that stuff. I think C8 and C10 is fine if people want to use a little bit of it. It does, compared to, long chain saturated fats, the randomized controlled trials and the systematic reviews and meta-analyses do show a metabolic advantage with MCT oil, C8, C10 versus, let's say, things like butter. So again, stick with the evidence, right?
I love that. And I'm grinning because I just had a very long, it wasn't a debate, but just going back and forth with someone who's just like, hey, all that matters are calories, right? All calories are the same. And it doesn't matter if you're getting a gram of fat from MCT or if you're getting a gram of fat from butter. And I'm like, oh man, like it was just a fun ride to kind of like go down that rabbit hole with them. But yeah, I agree. They're completely different metabolic responses, and you do see a metabolic advantage ultimately because it's being processed differently.
Let me give you an example of like what this actually translates into in the real world. So, for example, one study looked at changing only 6 grams of fat in someone's diet. So they basically removed 6 grams of fat from steak, and they replaced it with 6 grams of fat from fish oil. Within just 4 weeks, that caused a 2 pound fat loss and a 0.5 pound muscle gain. Just swapping out 6 grams of fat from steak to fish oil. So that is just, I mean, that is a tremendous change in just 4 weeks, just swapping out 6 grams of fat.
I'm going to need you to send me that study. That's freaking awesome, man. That's awesome. Now, I want to dive into that because you talk a lot about it, and I'm so excited and happy that you mentioned this in Superfuel, because people often forget about, like, hey, omega-3 versus omega-6. Like, they've heard about it, but you really went in and, like, hey, let's talk about these a little bit. So can you talk about the differential effects and kind of explain to people, hey, this is what omega-3 is versus this is what omega-6 is?
Yeah. So basically, omega-3s, there's two different types, basically. Some from plants, which is the parent omega-3 is called ALA, or alpha-linolenic acid. And then there are omega-3s that are called marine omega-3s, even though they don't necessarily have to be a marine source to get them. Those are your longer chain omega-3s, like EPA and DHA are the more commonly known long chain omega-3s. And then you have omega-6, generally high in nuts and seeds, which the parent omega-6 is called linoleic acid, which eventually gets elongated to arachidonic acid. So arachidonic acid is high in animal foods and this in omega-6 fat, and then you get a lot of linoleic acid from plant foods, but they're both omega-6. The key thing here, though, Ryan, is omega-6 isn't bad, is not inherently bad. It's when you isolate omega-6 that makes it super bad. Even organic cold press oils high in omega-6 are a problem because they got to hit your stomach acid first. And your stomach acid will automatically convert those cold pressed, let's say corn oil or sunflower oil, into hydrogen or hydroperoxides and aldehydes, which are some of the most toxic things that you can basically absorb and consume in the body. And here's a really interesting point. Oxidized omega-3s are completely different than oxidized omega-6. Your body utilizes oxidized omega-3s to upregulate endogenous antioxidant systems. So the body's got to have a mechanism to tell it that it's being damaged. And that mechanism is DHA. It's a super long chain omega-3, and it gets damaged first. That's a good thing, though. It is the alarm system to upregulate what's called NRF2, the antioxidant response element. And then you get upregulation of heme oxygenase 1, and I don't want to get too scientific here, but omega-3 oxidation in the body, again, forms healthy products, like 4-hydroxyhexanol is one product from DHA, and it's one of the most potent activators of your endogenous antioxidant system, whereas oxidized linoleic acid forms 4-hydroxynonenal, which is the most harmful aldehyde that you can ever form in the body. I wrote an entire paper and published that on the harms of 4-hydroxynonenal, and I had like 30 lines of evidence and like hundreds of references how this aldehyde literally can cross-link proteins, cause neurofibrillary tangles in the brain. And so that's why these isolated omega-6s are so bad, is because the oxidation products that they form.
Really good point. So basically the oxidation of omega-3 and omega-6 is very different. Is there a certain ratio that is just like, hey, because a lot of times people look at like your omega-3 to your omega-6 ratio. Is there like an ideal ratio that you've seen?
Yep. In basically simple terms, a 1-to-1 ratio of omega-6 to omega-3 seems optimal. But you can even get away with as high as a 4-to-1 ratio of omega-6 to omega-3. But if you look at like the Japanese, they tend to have like a 4-to-1 or 1-to-1 ratio. And obviously the Inuit had a very low, I think that their omega-6 to 3 ratio was like 0.3, meaning they consumed much more omega-3 than even omega-6. And again, that's important too, is we're super saturated in omega-6 nowadays, right? The average omega-6 to 3 ratio is 20-to-30-to-1. So
wow.
When you look at these fish oil studies that only give 1 gram of fish oil, the problem is there's, you still got an omega-6 to 3 ratio of 20-to-1. You didn't move the needle.
Right.
You're not going to find benefit. And so they finally came out with the Reduce It study, which published like 4 weeks ago. They finally gave 4 grams of omega-3s, and that caused a significant 25% reduction in cardiovascular amounts. You got to get the dose right.
That's huge. And I know you mentioned this in the book, and I, like, all these headlines came out, and I actually ran it past one of the people on our team, and she's like, yeah, when I was going through med school, like, they were like, do not consume fish oil, like, because it had all these things with, like, hey, it's going to increase prostate cancer and all these other complications. And you mentioned that. Do you think the reason that all of those studies that are a study that came out and initiated all those media headlines, was it because you're feeding a gram to people who are at a 20-to-1 ratio, and it's just like a drop in the bucket?
Exactly.
Oh, that's crazy. That is crazy. And so we're actually seeing drastic changes when you give a significant dosage of these. Now, when it comes to fish oil, I want to ask about the different types. So is there a certain amount of EPA or DHA that people should be looking for if they're looking at a fish oil supplement? Like, hey, I want to get this, because I know a lot of them listed out. Is there a difference, or just the total amount that really matters?
No, that's a good question. So you definitely want a fish oil that is high in EPA and DHA. Those are the two active ingredients. So you definitely want to turn the bottle around and be like, what the heck am I consuming here? You want it sourced from wild seafood, because if you source it from a farmed source, it's going to be higher in omega-6, and you're kind of, you know, counteracting what you're trying to do here. So you want to know the source of the omega-3s, the location too, like Alaskan Canadian waters, like extracting and getting a fish oil from, you know, let's say wild Alaskan salmon. That's a good source. That's another thing you want to look for. A dark capsule is another good thing you want to do. And I store my fish oil. A good fish oil will not freeze in the freezer. And I love storing it in the freezer because it not only reduces any potential oxidation that may occur, but it increases the shelf life too. So I can buy larger bottles and I know that it's staying fresh.
That's huge, because a lot of times I've mentioned this over and over again about the way fish oil is ultimately prepared and then delivered to you as a consumer matters. Because you see, you go to Walmart or you go to some of these stores nowadays and you see like this clear bottle that have clear capsules in it. Now, what's the main difference that you would see in like those fish oil that are sitting out there exposed to all this light and all these different things that have been sitting there for probably months versus one that actually is in like a black bottle or a bottle that you can't see through and has black a coating on it and then that you're storing in the freezer? What would be the major difference between those?
Yeah, a good company should actually be able to provide you a report that tells you the lipid peroxide, and you want that level to be less than 5%. So a fish oil that's just sitting there, and not sourced from a good source, doesn't have any additional antioxidants in the fish oil capsule, will have a lot more lipid peroxide. It'll be well above 5%.
Wow. And now what about, I think fish oil, like I tell people, it's like a staple. It's like one of those, like, hey, it doesn't matter who you are. Like there's benefits of having fish oil. When it comes, what about other aspects like krill oil? What are your thoughts on like krill versus fish oil?
Yeah, so I kind of use fish oil to get high amounts of EPA and DHA that are needed to reap the benefits of omega-3. So basically, you don't get really blood pressure lowering effects. You don't get artery dilating effects, platelet stabilizing effects, or atherosclerotic plaque stabilizing effects until you hit about 3 to 4 grams of EPA and DHA. You're never going to hit that just consuming krill oil. So I do take fish oil for that reason, but there are tremendous benefits to krill oil that you cannot get with fish oil. One of them being that the omega-3s are bound to phospholipids, so they're more bioavailable. More of them will form what's called lysophosphatidylcholine DHA, which is more readily taken up by the brain. So you want to boost brain omega-3, krill oil is a better version than fish oil. The other benefit of krill oil is what's called a xanthophyll carotenoid called astaxanthin. Now, this is way better than, let's say, beta carotene for numerous reasons. Astaxanthin is so cool because it doesn't form a prooxidant. It can accept 19 free radicals and never turn into a prooxidant. Vitamin C and vitamin E can't do that. They actually have to recycle each other. So vitamin C and vitamin E do form pro-oxidants. Astaxanthin does not. What's cool about astaxanthin is its structure. So it has a water-loving ring and another water-loving ring, so it can span the entire cellular membrane. So it protects not only your cell membrane, but the mitochondrial cell membrane, and it spans the entire width. So it's protecting the highly susceptible phospholipids from oxidizing, but also the cholesterol and the fatty acids, because it's spanning the entire cell membrane. It's preventing all of that polyunsaturated fats from oxidizing. This is like where so much of your damage comes from, is eating damaged fats, which get integrated into your cell membrane, and they last a long time until you replenish the cell membrane. Those damaged fats are sticking in there. And astaxanthin goes like this, whereas beta carotene pushes all the fatty acid tails around and can actually increase oxidation, because it sits basically perpendicular to the cell membrane, where astaxanthin spans the entire width. So astaxanthin is protecting outside of the cell membrane. It's also protecting the inside, where the cytosol is, where, you know, reactive oxygen species can be hitting you, but also the middle. So astaxanthin is a good krill oil. We'll have 1 milligram of astaxanthin per gram of krill oil. And all the studies show like a minimum effective dose of astaxanthin is about 4 milligrams, which is why I consume at least 4 grams of krill oil to get that amount of astaxanthin.
Got it. So you do like a combination of fish and krill.
Yep.
Awesome. When it comes to cooking, I want to talk a little bit more about oils. I remember back in the day when vegetable oil was like, hey, this is great, this is all this new alternative. When it comes to oils cooking, like now with all of the data and information that we have, what are some oils that you are things that you might suggest people cook with, and things that you suggest people kind of stay away from?
Yeah, I mean, like what you're bringing up, the concept that like something like corn oil is what we should be consuming. This literally just comes from the fact that corn oil can lower LDL cholesterol, even though it increases LDL oxidation. What's more important, your LDL oxidizing or a little bit lower of LDL cholesterol? I'll let that sink in a little bit. But, you know, those, again, isolated oils that are high in omega-6, when you cook with those, you are just producing a ton of basically lipid peroxides and aldehydes. And, you know, even inhaling those type of oil, like the smoke and the volatile chemicals that come off of, and the compounds that come off of oxidized omega-6, is not something you want in your kitchen. You know, definitely not.
For sure.
So you want to cook with a stable fat. And that's kind of where animal fats come in. You know, pasture butter. Coconut oil is obviously a plant fat, but a highly saturated fat type of cooking oil or butter or ghee. Those are things you probably want to cook with, because again, you're not going to form a lot of oxidation products. But the real mind blower is so many people think extra virgin olive oil should only be consumed cold pressed. But tested head to head with coconut oil, extra virgin olive oil had less oxidation products than even coconut oil, because it is so high in polyphenols, the oil just doesn't oxidize.
Interesting. And so like coconut oil, obviously people like, when you're on a ketogenic diet, it's like, hey, put coconut oil and everything, cook with it. But at some level, it has a certain smoke point where over that, you're starting to see some of this oxidation.
No, it's not even smoke point, Ryan. Actually, it had smoke points only determined by the 1% of the oil, which is the free fatty acid content. The study actually showed that the higher the smoke point, the actually more polar compounds or oxidation products were formed. Wow. And so that's why a lot of people think olive oil is bad to cook with, or butter or is bad to cook with, or even coconut oil somewhat bad to cook with, because it actually has a low smoke point compared to the vegetable oils. Like grapeseed oil has a tremendous high smoke point, but its omega-6 to 3 ratio is 700 to 1. And so that would be like the worst thing to cook with. And canola oil, everyone's confused about canola oil because it's high in omega-3, but again, it is probably one of the worst oils to cook with. So you don't want to cook with canola, you don't want to cook with corn or sunflower oil, but extra virgin olive oil or coconut oil are good, and even avocado oil is pretty good too.
Good. I was going to ask about that. So those are probably three ones that are pretty good, to safe bets to cook with.
Yep.
A couple other questions, because I just want to pick your brain on these, because you talk about it in Superfuel, and I know you mentioned it a little bit before. The true difference, and I think a lot of people get confused on grain-fed versus grass-fed when you're talking about like meat, and ultimately grass-finished. What's the real difference between a grain-fed meat versus grass-fed and grass-finished meat?
So basically, almost all meat will be grain-fed to a certain extent. Most of the difference is grass-finished versus grain-finished. And that actually, those 1 to 3 months of consuming grain dramatically alters the health benefits of that meat. Meaning, even though both animals were grain-fed, those last 1 to 3 months, there's a huge increase in omega-6. There's a reduction in omega-3 when you consume a grain-fed, let's say steak. And really, I think more of the issue is the reduction in antioxidant enzymes in the meat between the two, and also the reduction in CLA, which seems to have a lot of anti-cancer benefits that are found in grass-finished meat, a lot higher. Like you can get 10 times the amount of CLA or conjugated linoleic acid in grass-fed meat and finished meat versus grain finished meat. And then also vitamin E content. This is huge. Vitamin E is what is in foods to prevent fats from oxidizing. Vitamin E content in grass finished meat is again up to 10 times higher than grain finished meat. So when you cook the meat, that vitamin E in the grass fed meat is going to help prevent oxidation of the meat and the beta carotene too. That's why the fat in grass finished meat, it has an orangish yellow hue to it. Whereas, like your grain-fed steak was just going to have marbling that is pure white.
Wow, really interesting. I didn't even know that. That's a good point. But I know that a lot of times people get confused because you'll see a lot of meats that come out on the market and they're just like, hey, grass fed, but they don't say that they're grass finished. And you're like, well, if they're just like fed grass for a month or two of their lives and then they're finished with grain, it really wouldn't be the difference between the two. So I'm really glad you clarified that. One of the last things I want to talk about is in this book. If you had to say what does a super fuel day look like? Like, what is it? Is it like, hey, you're eating whole foods, you're getting exercise? Like, what does that truly mean? Of like, I'm gonna be like, if people want to leave and after they're done listening to this podcast, they're like, you know what? I want to become super fueled. What does that look like?
So it's basically like tossing out the stick of butter you're putting in your coffee and like the 2 pounds of bacon that you're eating and starting to eat things like wild salmon once a week, maybe some wild sushi sashimi once a week, consuming more nuts and seeds, like almonds, flax chia to boost your omega-3s, more pastured eggs. Throwing out the factory farmed eggs, which is like a gigantic like omega-6 fat bomb that's about to go off in your arteries. Don't want to eat factory farmed eggs. Worst thing you could do. So those are just some of the quick changes. Integrating some olive oil in your cooking, extra virgin olive oil, rather than, cooking with those omega-6 corn oils. So that's kind of like some of the quick things that you can do to be a super fueled ketogenic fat burner.
Love it. Love it. And I love this concept that you're bringing and really pushing forward of like a true, well-formulated ketogenic diet. And I can't let you leave without, because I know a lot of people are still going to ask about this cooked and then cooled concept. And I think it's fascinating because I've been doing this for a long time and like really focusing on like resistant starches. So can you just tell people like, yeah, there's a difference between if you have rice that's directly out of the pot versus if you have sushi that it's like cooked and then cooled rice. Can you talk a little bit about why that's different for someone that might not be like, hey, it isn't just rice?
Right. So when you cook a potato, the fiber basically kind of cooks out. When you cool it for 8 hours, you're recrystallizing the fiber again. So the studies actually show you quadruple, I will say that again, you quadruple the fiber when you put a potato in the refrigerator for 8 hours. So now you're consuming something that's less glucose and quadruple in fiber. Now, I didn't really understand the benefits of resistant starch until I figured out the mechanisms of why it's beneficial. But basically, what ends up happening, we published a paper on this, is when you consume resistant starch and the bacteria start fermenting that, you form short chain fatty acids. So think about, if you're so against fiber, think about you're fueling yourself with fat by eating resistant starch. If that's what you got to tell yourself, that you're a fat fueler, fat burner in the colon, that's what's basically happening.
Right.
So
it's the ultimate butyrate producer, right?
You got it. It's the ultimate, fat producer. Let's say fat. You're the ultimate fat burner when you're eating resistant starch. But basically, those short-chain fatty acids, they increase GLP-1 or glucagon-like peptide 1 in the intestine. And that can activate autophagy. That can activate insulin sensitivity. GLP-1 hits multi-organs and has numerous benefits. So really, resistant starch elevating this, pro-longevity hormone, so to speak, is one of the benefits. But also, obviously, you're feeding good gut bacteria, metabolize fiber. Bad gut bacteria, metabolize glucose. So you're going to boost out, you're going to boost the good bacteria, and you're going to suppress bad gut bacteria. And honestly, LPS, which is bacterial endotoxin, can be reduced by increasing resistant starch.
100%. I think the benefits of butyrate are just ridiculous. And that's why I think the amount of data that's out there on butyrate itself, and I think resistant starches can be a huge tool for people who say they're like, oh, I hate vegetables, or I hate getting this in. Cool, let's figure out a way to get you in some resistant starch in other ways then, cooked and then cooled items. Now, if you take a potato and you cook it, and then you put it in the fridge and you cool it, to get the benefits of like that fiber, do you have to eat it cold? Or, and then, because what happens if you heat it back up? Is it still there?
That's a great point. So me and, let's say, the godfather of resistant starch had a little debate about this. Tim Steele, who published the potato hack, he actually thought that when you heat it up, it actually increases the resistant starch. No, it doesn't increase it. It reduces it. It reduces it by only about 25%. So even if you reheat it, you're still getting three times the amount of fiber.
That's a good point. I didn't know that. I know that's like a big thing. And I was wondering like, hey, what happens if you cool it and then reheat it? So like everyone's so used to just like, hey, taking it directly out of the pot. And I think this is extremely important for people who aren't even on a ketogenic diet. Like getting more resistant starches, like if you're going to have like rice and some of these aspects. And it was one of the things I was really worried about. I was like, oh no, they're talking about cyclic ketogenic diets on this. I was super worried about it. But it's something that I look at and I'm like, hey, you did a really good job of like breaking that down.
Cool.
For sure. One of the things, and in the book, you guys do a great job of talking about, hey, this is what a cyclic approach really looks like. And you're talking about things like resistant starch and resistant fibers and like, hey, I'm incorporating in carbohydrates around my workout because it's I'm using carbs as a tool to fuel performance versus as an essential macronutrient, so to speak.
Right.
So, well, Dr. James, I know we've been talking for a while and I don't want to take up more of your time because I truly appreciate everything that you're doing for not only the keto community, but for the world, because I think both, not only the salt fix, but Superfuel, I'm super excited about to get in more and more people's hands because it's just going to be a great resource and really help, I think, the keto community as a whole from clashing with itself of being like, oh, everyone's just like, hey, this is keto, this is keto, this is keto. And you're like, well, let's make sure we understand a true, well-formulated ketogenic lifestyle. So with that being said, where can people get this? Where can people find Superfuel today when this goes live?
Yeah, so Barnes & Noble nationwide, they can get Superfuel. They can order it on Amazon, same with the Sulfix. And they can go to my website, drjamesdinick.com. If they want, I'm starting to put out some material there. I got a YouTube channel too, if people want to learn a little bit more. So
really cool. And so they can find you on, are you Instagram, YouTube, Facebook?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Dr. James Dinick, or, you got to follow me on my Dr. James Dinicolantonio professional Facebook page.
Awesome, man. Well, I really, truly appreciate your time. You've been a plethora of knowledge and research, and I'm super excited to continue watching you and supporting any way that we can. So just thanks for coming on today, and I hope a lot of people got a ton of value out of all of your information.
Thanks, brother.